God of War's been in development for about 3 years, roughly. It's including a fairly lengthy pre-production cycle. And basically, it came from Dave Jaffe's head.
There were so many ready-made play mechanics and gameplay mechanics in the Greek myths already that it was just like Medusa's head and Zeus's thunderbolts and battling Cyclopses, and that mixed with just my love of the material was like, okay, this is what we got to do. We got to do this game.
Dave Jaffe came up to me and goes, "What do you think about Greek mythology?" I was immediately intrigued by it. When they said, "Hey, we're thinking about Greek mythology for God of War," I was like, "Yeah, let's definitely do that." The creative director of the game, Dave Jaffe, definitely comes up with a lot of this kind of stuff, and he, you know, likes to involve the team in the design. So he comes up with ideas. You know, we sit around, he comes around, asks us his famous like 1 to 10, "What do you think about this idea?"
God of War is our attempt to really elevate the action adventure genre to the next level. We wanted to bring combat, exploration, navigation, puzzle solving, all of sort of the classic elements of the genre, but we wanted to bring those to players in a fresh way, in a way that they haven't really seen before, and also at a scope and at a level and sort of this epic feel that they haven't really gotten before in a game.
That's the whole idea behind God of War, is it's not just a game, it's an adventure like a movie.
The sheer amount of concept art and work that went into developing all the characters and the look and feel of the game is pretty unique. I've never seen so much effort put into concepting a game out, making sure that every environment is unique and fits in with the theme of the game overall.
I gave them my influences. It's really to their credit that they were able to sort of extrapolate what I was really going for into art, amazing art. So I ended up sort of getting what I wanted, which was this high adventure, amazing fantasy setting, which was inspired by the stuff that I grew up with, the movies that I grew up watching. But exactly how the game ended up looking the way it did was really, you'd have to ask the artist.
Charlie Nguyen has been part of the studio for quite some time, and what he's brought to God of War is extremely valuable.
A lot of my job is to create images of what the game feels like. The mood of the game is dark. The main character Kratos is a very disturbed character.
The things I said to him, I said brutal, nasty, violent, antisocial, pissed off, angry, fuck you. That was my direction to Charlie.
The hardest part about making Kratos was that the storyline wasn't really there yet. And so I was trying to create a character that didn't have that story behind him yet.
I just said, come into work and get angry and see what happens. What they came back with was their versions of anger and the things that they were mad at and the things that it was really kind of neat because you got to look at the concept art and kind of see how everybody dealt with anger and madness and chaos. The solution was to sort of start stripping away everything. Every time we took away a piece of armor, every time we took away a helmet, a shield, we started seeing more of this animalistic side to this character. Once we got that, it was just an issue of whittling it down, you know, from those 15 images, all of which felt the most brutal, and said, out of all these 15, that's the one. God of War is our attempt to really elevate the action adventure genre to the next level.
We're trying to do so much right now. I mean, we want to bring this, this experience to people, and we want it to be realistic. In order to do that, we have to push the PlayStation 2 as far as it possibly can go.
We use a well-known art package called Maya to do almost everything in our game.
When we first started the game, it was how do you create beautiful, lush environments that are high polygon count, high texture detail, beautiful lighting, and just consistent through the game.
Technologically, 4 or 5 years into a console, you know, most of the big problems have been solved. So it's just a question of doing it better than everyone else.
You first start with a sheet, and the sheet is also known as collision. That's the very bare bones minimum level of detail that the player actually interacts on. Any of these walls, the player can't go beyond. So this is the confines of the level. This is what you're actually playing in, but that's not what you see. That's what the game's running in the background. I turn the sheet off. Now you can see there's actual artwork associated with that.
Well, we definitely wanted to make the player feel like they were in ancient Greece.
You know, it's to go from really dark, depressing feelings, where you feel like, I just want to get out of here, to, very bright, and you're in the desert, and it's to make you feel like, wow, okay, it's a vast world. You know, it's really a big world out there.
God of War is gonna look real, but it's also gonna have a take to it, you know, like a little bit of a fantasy twist, over the top, like blood and guts.
I don't think that there's any other PlayStation game that achieves that's out there.
Every character in the game starts out with a single pose that every single animation derives from. But starting to move like this, bring in the base pose, and then kind of just start to block a few things out. Maybe even with General, just kind of moving the whole character all as one, getting the timing for things, and then building out from the pelvis. So get the pelvis motion right, then get the chest involved with the pelvis, and maybe start doing the arms, come back with the legs, then finish with the head and the fingers. So sort of whittling down until I get to that final look.
The original vision, I think, what we wanted was very, very brutal.
It's funny, because we were like, let's go find some fight scenes in movies, and that's how we want this guy to move, and that's how nasty we want him to be. And it's weird, because when we thought we'd find all these great movies, movie fights are really kind of tame when you think about it. And we actually ended up with only 2 or 3 movies that really, really obscure films, too, that really, when you saw it, you were like, oh my God, that is just some nasty stuff.
There's been quite a few gameplay design sessions or meetings with the animators where we get extremely... we move around a lot. My setup situation, as I'm putting enemies into the game and I'm trying to get them very playable so that they can be placed in levels and go around, is this big cartoony shaped, very bright arena. And it's just a big wide open space, and I put the guys in that, and I fight with them there, I tune them there, I set up all their moves and combos and their reactions.
The Medusa head animation. Ripping the head off the Medusa, very long development cycle for that one. It was redone several times.
We obsessed over it. I pissed off everybody. The animations aren't brutal enough. The art's not brutal enough. There's not enough blood. I want this game to make players just go nuts and feel that sense of anger and chaos.
We're really... really hammering the quality and trying to get it to be as top-notch as we can get it. There are several other games out there that I would consider that are kind of the top tier in animation, and we're trying to either meet or exceed what they do.
People are going to go, oh my God, this is what action-adventure games have supposed to have been since the very beginning. I would say this is the game I've been wanting to make since I was a little kid.
God of War, from a production perspective, has been extremely challenging. There's a number of areas that, we've really been pressed. Time, money, resources.
Making the game was definitely a fight. Me and the team butted heads a lot. And there was this anger, I guess, that built up inside of me that I think I really transferred over to Kratos. And I look at Kratos now and it's like, that's me.
I think we verbally abuse each other multiple times during the day. It's one of those, it's a great high-low thing. Start out the day, we're really happy, and then throughout the day, we get very upset with each other, and then happy with each other, and then upset, and hopefully we can leave and we're happy with each other, and we come back and we're happy with each other again.
I'm always the guy that the engineers want to strangle because I try to absolutely push this engine to the max.
We've wanted to strangle each other at least once a week.
Prospect of beating the shit out of other workers has, you know, occasionally arisen.
We have not actually had any fist fights on the game yet.
Fist fights certainly aren't allowed in a professional environment.
If we're going to get into a physical fight, it's going to happen in the next 3 months. We're going into the most stressful time of making a game, which is the alpha-beta process.
Alpha, baby.
So we're an hour from alpha. Nothing's tuned and nothing's finished.
What I am is tired.
Tired.
Tired. Tired and more tired.
This is what alpha is, right? All the pieces are there, but it doesn't play right yet, and it doesn't feel right yet. And
there are a couple of big bugs that people are working on. If we don't get them by 7, then we'll get them done by 8 or 9 or 10.
Three years, and we're almost done. Light at the end of the tunnel.
I'm so happy we're an hour away from being able to say, at least we have a game.
Playtesting is fantastically important, and this is the first game that we've really gone to town on the playtesting while the game has been in development. We'll bring, you know, 5 or 6 people in from the local colleges. And we'll sit them down in front of the latest version of whatever level we've been building, and we'll watch them play it. And we'll notice all the things that they don't do right, or all the times that they can't find the way to solve a puzzle because we've obviously not highlighted it well enough. Or if they can't see the door in the background, then we'll add an extra light in so it's highlighted. It's really kind of like making it's like making a movie. At the beginning of the project, we decided we were going to build a playtesting room in our office, and that has proved to be a very good decision.
There's our huge PlayStation room. So good to be one of the big titles this year, so hopefully it'll get some attention that we think it deserves. I think whether you're into mythology or not, I think you can't deny the power of a game made by passionate people.
God of War is a game that anyone can pick up and play and have a really fun experience.
You should play God of War because it'll get you laid.
This is the adventure that the back of the box has always promised you.
God of War is fucking rad.
Ravaged Athens. Legions of undead soldiers. Greek mythology's greatest beasts. Deceptive god. Are no match for the fury of one vengeful warrior. God of War.
This is our sort of batch of things that you didn't get to see. That some of them I'm glad you didn't, and some of them I wish you would have, time permitting, but it wasn't. So here we go. Okay, now this is actually this. Now this wasn't a deleted level. This was the prototype that the team put together. I don't even know what the date on this is, but you know, 3 years ago, and it was really just to get the basic mechanics, not even tuned or anything. But you know, you could run, you could swim, you could swing, and if you look at this level a little bit, you'll see we certainly didn't reuse any of the main art, but you'll see kind of like that shot there is sort of the precursor to some of the shots we have in the game. The rope swinging mechanic, and a lot of this, so you'll recognize if you've played the game and remembered the game, you'll recognize some of the like the level when you pull into Athens at first. This bottom section is based on that, and the whole cliffs that you climb here, we actually just sort of ripped these out directly from the demo and built the cliffs level, the Cliffs of Madness or the Cliffs of Insanity. I forget what we ended up calling it. God, it's amazing to see this little guy running around. He looks so not like Kratos. That guy there was the original Cyclops who's dying, who just never really looked like a Cyclops. He just looked like a big guy with a stick. And then this was the room, the only room that we built that was like the final room, and everything else was kind of rough. And I remember seeing this and going, everybody saw this and said, man, this looks awesome. And then we were like, yeah, but how in the hell are we going to get, you know, all the levels in the game looking as good as that? And I don't know if we ended up getting them all looking as good as that, but I think we came a lot closer than I thought we would. This level's pretty cool. This was our test level for the Icarus wing. So, Icarus and Daedalus, the Icarus story where he flew too close to the sun with the wings that he had made, and the wax melted and he fell to his death. That was sort of the inspiration for the mechanic, and I still love this. I absolutely wish this had made it into the game. We just, you know, it really came down to time and going, you know what, let's focus, let's get our fighting really good, and let's get our platforming better, and let's get our puzzles working, and maybe we can come back to this. And as is often the case, you just never have the chance to. So I'd love to see something like this, you know, in future God of War titles, because I think it's a great, it's just fun. I mean, it's fun to fly around. And what was cool about this is it wasn't just a flying level. It was, you know, you could land and you could walk around, and it was very a seamless experience versus, you know, now it's time for the flying level. So that was pretty cool. Yeah, I look at this now and I'm like, damn, we should have gotten that in. Wouldn't be awesome. These were the original Harpies. They were a lot bigger. They still read better. They look awesome, but we just realized we needed more of like a bat-like, small-like little annoyance enemy. These guys played like the skeletons, basically flying versions of the skeletons, and there just wasn't much of a difference in gameplay, so we ended up kind of shrinking them down and making them bats. And this was what we called the Mounting the Titan level, which is Kronos, the giant titan in the desert. And sadly, right now, the only way you get on the Titan is through a movie. And originally, this was how it was going to be. You see this big thing, it's like a big watermelon in the background. That's actually Kronos. And Tobin, the designer, he's got him kind of moving towards the player. And those things that are falling are like mountains that are crumbling and stuff. So it's kind of like Kronos is rushing towards the player, crawling, and you're trying to run ahead of him in these platforming sections, so that you can ultimately jump onto the structure that's on his back, and that'll lead you up to the temple. And I still love that idea. I really, really wish we could have done it. And it was just, we showed this to the tech guys, and we showed it to the artists, and they were just like, dude, that's going to take forever. This was the original boss. There was a boss that originally, that's awesome, that originally guarded Pandora's box. And again, we just didn't have time. And I know it's lame that that's the one thing I regret about the Pandora design, is that there are no bosses that guard the box. You have the Minotaur boss down below, and then we've got this conveyor belt section, and that's kind of it. And we just ran out of time. But this was originally pretty cool. It was, you know, you had this moving platform up above. You had this giant kind of harpy vulture in the center, that was guarding the box. And she had these eggs scattered all around the level. And in order to sort of entice her to fly around, you'd have to go find her eggs and break the eggs. And you'd kind of take the little baby birds inside, and you'd kind of carry them around and use them as bait. And again, not only was it kind of a cool mechanic, because you were having to get, you were slower as you carry these things around, but also I think it really helped with the character of Kratos. I mean, here he is, you know, cracking open eggs and ripping out little infant birds and using them for his own his own desires and really pissing off this mama bird, I thought was pretty cool. So here's just another quick idea. These are almost like little sketches for levels, you know, where you have a big open environment and then you've got the walls come down and it becomes a maze, and you either do something and the walls come back up, or it's on a timer. I mean, we did tons of these things, you know, where I'd have an idea or a designer would have an idea and it was like, you know, try something like this. So this level is actually a level that we went so far as that we showed the press, we got it in magazines, and this was really a hard cut for us to make, and for especially for me to make. I love the mechanic of it, and I love the platforming and the concept. And the concept was that you're riding this elevator, and you know, if you get knocked off, obviously you'll die. And if you get off the elevator, the idea was it was going to originally be being chased by this massive sandstorm. And the elevator was really the only thing. It was sort of a magical elevator that protected you from the sand. And if you got off the elevator would bypass you and the sandstorm would engulf you and kill you. And we just, the two things we didn't have time to do is we didn't have time to tune it, and we didn't have time to build the sandstorm. But what I loved was this whole idea of, you know, getting off the elevator and having to catch back up with it. So, you know, you'd have these little forks in the road, and either you'd be forced, like coming up, you'd be forced to get off the elevator, or you could choose different paths. If you took one path, it was more combat heavy, one path was more platform heavy. And as you can see, I mean, we had this pretty much finished from a standpoint of the art and the setup, but we were missing the big sandstorm, and we were missing the tuning time to really make this fun, and so it ended up getting cut. This I love. This was great. This is great. I love this. The elevator now gets smaller. I guess we talked about putting this in the actual, see, they suck. Whoever played this couldn't keep up with the elevator, but that was the whole idea, trying to keep up with the elevator. So it's tough. It's really tough when you have to cut ideas that you're really passionate about out of the game, but you do so you can make the other ideas that you do have in the game shine even brighter. So it's sort of a constant process, or it's a constant aspect of the process that's just a really tough thing that you go through, but I think it's worth it because it makes the overall product better.
Some of the earlier characters that had been played around with, some of them again just didn't feel right for the time period. Some of them either felt overdressed or felt too fantasy. A lot of the concepts too got very detailed. There were lots of flowing things, and there was lots of hair, and there was lots of things that if we had to just model it, it probably would have been a little bit tougher to pull it off. There was one character I remember when I first saw it that had kind of a almost kind of a tribal feel to it, a very kind of African feel to it, which I thought was pretty cool. Didn't say Greek, but at the same time when I looked at that, I thought, you know, that would be a pretty cool character to work with.
We went through images of the lone wolf kind of characters where might have a hero with a little baby or a dog on his back. So just to kind of give something different, you know, about the character and something that you can kind of relate to.
One of the original concepts behind the hero for God of War was to come up with a guy who was, his whole face was encased in a mask. And we thought that going with a mask would be, you know, being able to paint his face in broader strokes so that when you were playing the game, he still had a lot of personality. You could still sort of read that when you saw the mask. But when we actually got it in the game, it ended up feeling very soulless, and it didn't feel like the guy had a personality.
That was always one of the big elements that we were dealing with. You know, and it was difficult because, you know, we would often hear, "It's not Greek enough," and we're like, "What does that mean?" I'm using a actual, you know, sometimes because we'd take it right from a Greek, some Greek sources, you know, and it's very Greek. But I think what we really started seeing was, okay, no, it's not. It's not Greek enough according to what the general public knows. And that's kind of what we had to go towards.
These are, again, very traditional. Some of these were very traditional kind of Greek images. And again, the more traditional it got, the more armor we put on him, the more he lost his individualism.
Every time we put something on, you know, Dave felt like, he doesn't look brutal anymore. And we started realizing brutal also kind of related to the primal part of him, you know. And so we did spend a lot of time going through that, but in the end we ended up still taking his clothes off, and that's what we went with, so.
When I first saw this from Charlie, it was the first time that I really saw the brutal nature and the violent nature and the sort of the animalistic quality that would really become the foundation for Kratos. And I think starting to see these images was just like sort of confirmation that this idea could really work. And instead of giving him a traditional sword, going with these sort of chain blades was going to be much more dynamic and fluid and really fun to play with. The main goal for the character in the game was always to create someone that looked really brutal and really nasty and really violent. Instead of sort of going down the traditional route of a iconic Greek hero with the plume helmet and the skirt and the toga and the sandals, we wanted someone who really made the player feel like he was being able to unleash his dark side. So the idea was always, how can we make him look more brutal? How can we make him look more violent and impulsive and nasty? And that desire always superseded sort of historical accuracy. So while you look at this guy and he may not totally feel at home in ancient Greece from a costume standpoint, I think he achieves the greater purpose, which is to give players a character that they can play who really does let them just go nuts and unleash the nasty fantasies they have in their head.
So the idea on the environments and trying to create a Greek world was trying to create a feeling that reminded you of Greece and that didn't feel too fantasy. So we were trying to walk that fine line between a fantasy game environment and a traditional Greek environment. And so part of it was again, trying to get stuff that made it feel Greek, not Roman, but Greek.
Okay, when we first start concepting out environments, it wasn't really defined as levels, you know. We picked out the important locations such as Pandora and Athens and Hades, and all I knew is like the game should feel really big, which means there's no like cramped area. It's more like challenge against the god and like huge monsters. So the look of the environment should be like huge, you know?
So with each of the environments, what we tried to do was kind of move you through the world using color to kind of help move Dave's story along and kind of emphasize the emotional impact of what he was trying to, of the story he was trying to tell. But at the same time, if I've just come out of the ocean, where I'm battling the Hydra, where we've got, in that case, you know, there's more kind of greens and blues and things like that. I don't want to go into that same scenario color-wise again. It's like if I did the whole game in black and white, you'd get probably bored with it after a while. So one of the interesting aspects, especially in the Pandora section, was a lot of times you'll see multiple iterations on statues as well. And one of the reasons was that one of David's ideas was he wanted those statues to come to life, whether it was Atlas or Poseidon rising out of the water. The things that were in that environment, the objects, the architecture, those types of things reflect what was going on, again, with David's story. So in Pandora, as an example, that whole sequence is about an architect who, in David's mind, is basically gone mad. And so the idea was the structures, the traps, the visual look of that should begin to reflect kind of a madman in some instances.
I did that piece, even the level, the design wasn't solid yet. So, but my own interpretation, I was thinking it's like things are like, there's no gravity, but at the same time, things are like kind of shifting all the time. And this infinite distance in the back, things are flying, falling, exploding. The Mountain Olympus, that one particularly, it's not for the game art. It's more like okay, we want to talk about Mount Olympus. So where's the image? That kind of thing.
The goal of the world of God of War was really to create a place that felt like, you know, a giant theme park ride, you know, or a giant set on one of these great high adventure movies, and places that you'd really want to explore and spend time in and really feel like you were having this grand adventure. And I think these guys, you know, week after week, continually were able to come up with set pieces and ideas that they just top themselves constantly and continually, and they've really given us this great world to play in, and I think they did an amazing job, and I'm so grateful as a player that I get to actually play in this space.
When it came to the characters and monsters and creatures that our hero is going to encounter, we're dealing with characters and creatures that everybody is familiar with. Medusas, Cyclops, centaurs, minotaurs. One of the things that we had to do with all the characters, and I think you'll see this as you look through the concept art, one of the things that was very important to me was that when somebody looked at any of our characters, that they knew what they were. So what we could do basically there, as long as the character was down on all fours and I had three heads, you probably would accept that character as a Cerberus. Whether it was a werewolf, whether it was a dinosaur, you know, again, you would still accept that in our world and what we were doing in terms of building the mythology we were building, you would accept that.
As far as a game creature is concerned, mostly what was fascinating me was the deep sea creatures and how freaky they looked, and I was trying to pull up on some of that, and did a number of different types of hydras.
I was told, okay, Ares would be maybe 90% elemental, 5 or 10% human, you know, and so that's kind of what I was going for on these beginning ones. He's just pure power, you know, almost like he's an unstoppable force. And then, you know, Dave liked it. It's just he wasn't sure how we would do it. Probably was a slow transition towards being more human. So it's still kind of a huge guy, but he's got all this armor on that allows him to do all these things.
So the idea was, again, to move a character into something that, again, would be a little bit more in the horror direction. And again, what it allowed us to do was get characters that were still reminiscent of what they were supposed to be in Greek mythology, but were uniquely ours. So once we started moving in that direction, again, it opened up a whole new kind of avenue of ways to explore those characters. What we really wanted to do was keep people immersed in the mythology, in the Greek mythology, but give them a different kind of experience when it came to the characters and the creatures.
When men ask for the origin of Kratos, the true tale was never known. The truth is that Kratos, like all men, began life as a child. But childhood in ancient Sparta was a brutal existence. Children deemed fit and strong were trained to be warriors, the protectors of Sparta. The weaker children were caged, sent to the mountains to fend for themselves. They were not expected to survive. And while Kratos escaped the fate of the weaker children, his brother was not so lucky. The two, once inseparable, were now alone. Kratos would become legend, but the story of his brother has gone untold. A child left in the mountains, he had died years before. Coming of age in the underworld, he had but one desire. Revenge against the brother who deserted him all those years ago.
Thank you.
Kratos had accomplished more than he'd ever dreamed possible. But he did not sit easily on his new throne. There was a secret in his past even he did not know. A secret he burned to uncover. Born out of wedlock, Kratos was the bastard child of a shunned woman. There were rumors as to who the father was. Rumors that grew more and more preposterous. Until the woman finally left her small village. She swore a new life in Sparta. Kratos would never know the truth. Never know who his father really was. But now, as a man, Kratos returned to Sparta, determined to find his mother and discover the truth. Kratos' mother was not long for this world. Before she passed, Kratos demanded she tell him the truth. His mother knew the price she would pay if she revealed the name of Kratos' father. But it was time, at last, for her son to know who he was. No word need be spoken to bring about the prophecy of the curse. He was transformed into a merciless beast, one which would destroy even her own son. Putting aside the last remnants of affection for his mother, Kratos destroyed the beast she had become. With her last breath, she spoke the name of his father. For Kratos was no mere mortal. He was the son of a god. He was the son of Zeus, the father of Olympus. And with that knowledge came the certainty that one day soon, he would take his revenge against the father. Against the god who had abandoned him all those years ago. The tale of Pandora's box remains to this day. After the weapon was taken from the temple, the structure endured. Kronos the Titan lived another 1,000 years, wandering the desert. That was long ago. The temple has gone silent, and the beast who bore it for so long has died. Relics of a world long past. But all myths need not be from the ancient times. Today, a band of explorers will make their way inside the just-discovered structure and find for themselves the temple still holds many dangers and many secrets. Soon, as with all great myths, a new hero will emerge.
By the gods, you've done it. Somehow you found your way here to me. I offer you my congratulations and my respect. Together, we shall conquer the perils that lay before us, and we shall always...
Kratos, dude, they did it. They found our Easter egg.
Who are you?
It's me, David Jaffe. I directed the game.
What game?
Your game, God of War?
Go away or
I'll... Dude, don't you get it? These guys, they spent all that time breaking those statues. I mean, they must have taken, like, forever. And then they figured out the whole secret code thing.
I do not know what you are talking about.
We hid the secret pretty damn deep, huh, Kratos?
If I kill you, I will get health orbs.
But wait. If you got the secret from the net or a magazine, then actually you kind of suck. I mean, work for it a bit, right, Kratos? Actually, can I call you Krait?
No. Go away or I'll...
Don't you hate it when they get the codes off the net? It's so lazy. Hey, say, Krait, what are you so pale for?
I am serious.
You know, up close, you actually look kind of pasty, if you don't mind me saying. It's kind of gross.
All right, that's it!
Oh, jeez! What are you doing? Wait! Ah! We gotta make the sequel!
He was worse than a screeching harpy! As I was saying, you have found the secret. You have done well. Congratulations, mortal. We will meet again.